the middle of September. You see the tip of this? You see this thing's putting on new growth? Look at these tips. Brand new growth. Look at my neighbor's trees. They're all going dormant. These are acting like it's April. We're going to stop growing. They don't know how to stop growing. I'm telling you, man, all my neighbor's trees, these things are full fall color, acting like we're not going to stop growing.
Did you have your neighbors coming over asking?
I'm glad you asked. Everybody listen to me. And here's the word. The natural man cannot. It's not a choice thing. It's not a would not. It's a capacity thing. The natural man cannot receive the things of God. Neither can he know them because their spirit says that all my neighbors went to school. They're highly educated. And because they're here, they can't get it. They can't get it because they're here. I'm so glad I never went to school. I just watch what God's doing. I ask him, how do you grow stuff without water? He says, come and we'll show you. And because he's doing it, I can do it. I never had the hang up of school saying I couldn't. So they're all telling you in school, this won't work.
This can't work.
It won't work. They're telling you that in school. So I'm just so glad I just got free of not having to go to school and didn't have to have my brain erased. I just said, well, God, you're doing it. I can do it. Just to give you an example how powerful that is, in January 1990, Sunset Magazine did an article on my orchard. Sunset Magazine. How it got there was, I give my apples everybody because I have so many. One of my friends had some apples. He gave one to a friend of his who was an editor for Sunset Magazine. The guy eating the apple on the way home got his pants wet. Look at the water content.
Because of the juice.
Look at all the water in it. So he calls me and he says, I have never had an apple so much water content. He says, how do you get so much water in your apples? He says, well, that's an interesting question. I've never watered my trees. I don't have water. I've never irrigated. I don't know how the water gets here. He says, no way. I says, I don't have water. They've never been watered. I don't believe you. So he comes up here and he does this article. That October, a whole suburban load of a Washington State University professors show up to look at this thing that's not watered. And they're looking at my neighbor's tree. All the leaves are off. These things are in full leaf, fall color, and a load of the fruit that tastes like this. And they're flipping out like, this is amazing. And one of these guys looks at the ground and says, oh no. You're going to destroy his orchard with all these wood chips. I said, excuse me? Destroy the orchard with the wood chips? He says, yes, wood products type nitrogen make your soil acidic. And I tell you, I something rose up. I says, let me tell you something, sir. I didn't go to school, but I'm not stupid. You see that forest out there? Let's get real. You see that forest out there?
The whole floor is covered.
This has been going on for 6,000 years of recorded human history. It's superior to anything you have in school. All your chemicals, all your stuff doesn't compare to that incredible, sustainable environment, and it's maintained on 100% wood products. Needles, leaves, cones, broken branches, broken trees that no one rakes up. And you're telling me this is going to fail? If you tell me I got a nitrogen pipe, how come everything's so green? How come the grass on the edge of the wood chips is the thickest and the greenest? I mean, help me, I'm not seeing it. I'm seeing the opposite.
Right.
And they walked off, totally convinced. And that's when God said to me, the natural man cannot. That's when I got it.
They just went away scratching their head and they didn't get it.
They came back the next time I was angry. And I told them, I said, the issue is here is money. Everything you teach is dependent on your chemical fertilizers, your pesticides, herbicides. And without that, your system will fail. You can take everything away from me, even pack my water off, and I'll grow everything superior to what you're growing. Because that's the natural order.
How about your genetically modified seeds that you want to sell for a premium price?
I have nothing to do with those. I don't want any of that trash. And it's absolutely thankful no one around here has it either.
We don't want that garbage down where we're at.
Let me start here. We haven't started yet. This is all I start here with a couple of disclaimers. I have absolutely nothing to sell, and this is not about me. What this is about is this incredible good God who comes from a place of love and light, who really loves his creation, has provided very well for us. And I want the whole point of this is for you to get his goodness and his abundance and how beautiful the system is and how very simple it is. And that's my whole purpose. Let's just start here because I want to show you.
Well, yes. That sounds like better than going to church and putting money in the envelope. It just sounds more real to me.
He's real. Yeah, he's good. He is so good, and he loves his kids, and he's responsible. He provided everything we need in abundance. But we have an enemy who's done his best to rob, kill, and destroy. Mm-hmm. And he needs to be exposed. Paul says, don't be ignorant of his devices, and I want you to see the awesomeness of the Creator. Let me show you some interesting contrasts. These are the kind of things that get my attention. You see across the fence in my neighbor's yard, a rhododendron growing. You know, I'm just telling you, we're being observant here, we're just looking. Now you can tell, it's not happy, it's alive, it's growing, but it's not well. You know, and you can just see it's and I want you to notice this rhododendron here. Now in the natural mind, this rhododendron is growing next to a huge sequoia tree that's sucking everything out of the ground to support it. And it looks like that, with no attention, no water, no fertilizer, no nothing. It looks like that. Look at all the buds on it. Look closely at how many buds are on there. And the density and the beautiful foliage, with absolutely no attention, growing next to a tree that's sucking everything out of the ground to support it. Excuse me? I'm just saying, man, these are the things that rock my brain, because I wasn't told this in school. I was told, this won't work. You can't grow stuff next to it. And look at this poor thing over there. You know, side by side, wow. Same environment. This has a wood chip covering. That has none.
Don't you want to throw some wood chips over once in a while?
No, this is so beneficial for you. But I want people to see the contrast.
It's powerful. It is.
Cherry tree here, I was here 34 years ago physically when my neighbors planted it. That tree is a Royal Ann cherry and it's 34 years old. And I was here when they planted it.
This tree here?
This cherry tree right here. I want you all to take a mental picture of the trunk, the size of the tree, the color of the foliage, because we're going to go look over at one over here. That's the exact same tree, a Royal Ann cherry that's 20 years younger. And I want you to compare it.
I'm going to get this powerful comparison right here.
Do you put wood chips on every year?
No. The last time I put wood chips in the orchard was 12 years ago.
Oh, wow.
How long ago? 12 years ago.
How deep did you put them?
16 inches and right up to the tree trunks, which they say you can't do.
Okay.
Are you hearing me?
Right up to
16
right
inches to deep. That's this. Right up to tree trunks. Okay. And all the books say you can't do it. Exact same cherry, Royal Ann, and it's 14 years old. 20 years younger than that one. Look at the trunk. Look at the color of the foliage. Look at the size, and I'm pruning it because it's getting too big. This is 20 years younger than that one. Same space, get same lighting, same ground. This has a covering. I mean, this is dramatic. This is not like slightly different. This is like huge.
Yeah.
Look at them.
Die right now.
Yeah.
Have you topped this one out at all?
I'm pruning it all the time because it's growing like crazy.
So
that one never. That was never pruned. You see, my challenge is trying to stop stuff.
Do you stop them start growing them from seeds?
No, this was. I brought this in as a plant. Okay. You know, but this is 14 years old. That's 34 years old.
That's amazing.
Now, does anybody like arugula?
Arugula. Help
yourself.
I don't like it very much.
I want you. If you don't like it very much, just try it because I think you'll have a change of thought.
Arugula, hon.
It's tart. It's, you know, it's a
little battery.
Do you ever
have some arugula? That's one of my least favorite, and they're putting it in all salads now. Oh, that's not bad.
That's tasty.
Did you hear him?
What?
That's my least favorite, and they put it in all salads, and his next comment is, that's not bad. That's what I want people to see. Isn't that good flavor to it?
Yes.
And what I want you to get through your experience today is everything you're going to eat here is totally different than what you've had. Mm-hmm. Totally different, because the stuff you've had has come from depleted, corrupted soil that has no life in it and doesn't taste like the creator made it. Like my neighbor's dog came in here and dug all my stuff out. You see how nice it all goes back to the rake? Now, soil preparation. Anybody here a gardener? Does gardening?
Yes. Come here. I want you to
name.
Yeah.
Huh? Go ahead. Hard worker, son.
All of you. Here we go.
All right.
Now you see when you tilt when you prepare soil to plant your garden. Come up over here. I want you to. And somebody walks and compacts it. I want you to as best you can compact my soil there. Just stomp it down real good and really compact it. See, when someone does that to your tilled ground. No, you're not done yet.
It ain't compacting. I mean, it's spreading.
Yeah. I want you to notice this because you see this is not your experience in the garden. Now you can see what he's doing.
Yeah.
Now watch this. Step aside.
I'm digging a hole.
Look at that.
Yeah.
Absolutely no impact.
How deep is that?
Well, there's the grade. There's the grass. Not very deep.
No. I'm here.
There's the grass.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's not very deep.
Look. 6-8 inches, maybe.
Okay.
But you see, what I want you to get is that the only thing I have to do to plant my garden is come out with my rake, grade it out like this, make a groove, cover it, I'm done. That's it. Year round. Never any soil preparation. Ever. For you gardeners, I hope you're getting this?
This is after it's decomposed.
No, this is immediately. I'm going to take you out here and show you in the wood chips how you do it immediately.
Okay.
I'm just saying, the Creator never designed. You ever notice the Creator has never disturbed the ground? He never mixes, and everything grows great. Now, I live in a place where you cannot grow grapes. This is Western Washington. I'm 600 feet above sea level. And I want you to notice, if you look under there, you can see those beautiful clumps of grapes hanging. I cannot grow grapes here.
That's what the books say, right?
And I'm going to take you over and show you that I have the same grape plant growing in my chicken pen that doesn't produce grapes. The reason this is producing grapes is because I have a pile of wood stack behind it that catches the heat and acts as a heat sink, and it's warmer here.
Okay.
I'm just telling you, it's so amazing when you start connecting with God and He starts opening your eyes and showing you how you can change all these things. That's by creating little spaces, little environmentally warm spaces. Do stuff they say you can't. But look at the color of that. And this grape is only 4 years old. It's never been watered or fertilized. Can I tell you the power of this grape? This is huge. I had a young family, beautiful young family, came up from Chile, South America, in a motorhome to see my grape. The reason is that this family grows the grape, those Red Star grapes that they sell all the world. He says he grows the best. When he saw the film, he was grieved because he knew in his heart that he's poisoning people all over the world with his grapes because they're grown in chemical fertilizers, pesticides, herbicides, and fungicides that he has to use to grow grapes like that. When he saw my film and realized I'm using nothing, he had to come and see it. And his kids came and ate those grapes. And he looked at the foliage. Look at those. No bug bites, no anything. And he totally gave his hope that potentially I can grow grapes that won't poison him. This has never been touched. I don't do anything.
Why no bugs?
Why no bugs? I'm so glad you asked. You see, when I started to connect with God and realize who He is, I come to this place where, you know the term they use for bugs that starts with a P?
Pests.
Pests. And I'm in my mind going through this now, why would a good God whose essence is love create a pest? It doesn't line up with His character. So I ask Him, God, talk to me about bugs, because I don't see that in your character, creating a pest. He says, they're not pests. They're my police force. And what I created them for was to maintain a healthy environment. They're designed to take out weak, unhealthy, diseased plants, stress plants, so only healthy plants produce seed and maintain healthy plants. You see, if unhealthy plants were allowed to live and produce seed, plants become extinct. They get weaker and weaker. So God has had insects go around and take out all the weak and the disease, so only the healthy plants produce seed and maintain healthy plants. And they gave me an example. He says, you look in nature when predators go hunting for food, predators. They go after the weak, the old, and the crippled because they're trying to maintain a healthy crop. And he says, everything in nature except the human race is totally connected to me for the support and maintenance of the environment. Everything except us. And then he gave me the most awesome illustration. I had this young woman comes from South Dakota on a tour. She works in an Indian reservation where she says everyone in the reservation has diabetes. The kids because they're eating junk food, the adults because they're alcoholics. The elders are really worried because we're losing our tribe, and they're realizing we've got to start growing food because the stuff in the store is killing us. But they're not farmers. They were hunters-gatherers. They don't know how to farm. And they're watching what America's doing, and they're realizing intuitively this is not how to do it. So this is, when I saw this film, I realized they'll get it. All they have to do is start dropping seeds in the woods and stuff will grow. So I gave her some of my kale over here. As soon as she took a bite, she's running to her car and says, "What are you doing? I'm getting a bag. I just went to the store and bought kale. It tastes like this." So she's picking my kale. I told her about the insects. And she's picking it at the very bottom. She says, "Look at this. There's a slug eating the dead leaf of the kale." It wasn't eating the healthy, vital kale. It was eating the dead leaf. And then God gave me the most powerful illustration. I have celery growing in my garden. Any of you growing celery? The seeds are tiny. They look like dust. And it's impossible to get them spaced just right. You drop one and three fall. You know, kind of thing. So I'm thinning my celery. And I've got these beautiful plants. This is, I'm going to throw these away. So I'm going to go plant my herb garden. In my herb garden, it's all wood chips. And I have never seen a slug there, ever. They're all around my grass, but not my herb garden. The next day, after I planted those celery, because I bare-rooted them and they were stressed and they're all wilted over, the next day the place was covered with slugs munching down the celery I planted. And I'm just, God talked to me. He says, "Just watch." I love him. He comes with these cool little saying, just watch. And I says, "Watch, there's only anything left." He says, "Just watch." Come back the next day and they're all stumps. He says, "Tell me to keep watching, just watch." The third day was powerful. I come back the third day and there was no slug. And he said this. He said, "The slugs never bothered your celery in the garden because it was always healthy and vital. When you move them, they were stressed and they put out a signal, a message, 'I'm dying, take me out.' As soon as they overcame that stress, that signal stopped and the slugs were gone. The celery grew great from the stumps. It was awesome. And I got it. I got it. Nature is so connected, so totally in line. The communication is so perfect. It's huge. It's only us that's disconnected. Don't get it. It's so beautiful to see. When I came here, I had all kinds of insect issues and fungus and stuff in my trees. I have none now because the trees are well. And I just, if you're in good health, you're properly hydrated, you're eating well, you have a good mental attitude, you're getting proper sleep, you can be around people coughing, sneezing, flus, everything. It doesn't bother you because your immune system is working. But if you're stressed, you're worn out, you're dehydrated, you'll get sick. Yeah. It's just such a, if you're just paying attention, the design is so perfect. You know, and it's so pathetic how we in this educated culture, allopathic medicine, we have a headache, we take a Tylenol. That's as insane as when the red light comes onto your car, saying your oil's low, to unscrew the bulb. The headache is a symptom that you're not taking care of yourself. You're stressed, you're not eating well. Correct your lifestyle, the headache goes away. Don't go pulling a light bulb out. Come on. It's just so stupid. And we're always treating symptoms. We don't go to the root problem. Like, you have an issue here. You got to correct. And if you'll correct that, that symptom, that warning light, goes away. It's just, it's so incredible.
I have a question.
Yes.
So this row here, when you showed how you cut your
trench, make a little groove,
yeah. Yeah. Your groove, is that what you did there? Just
everywhere.
Just right on the surface,
everywhere.
So that?
Everywhere.
So those were planted, I mean.
Quarter inch, and let me track with you.
Yeah.
Ever notice in nature how weeds get planted? You ever see God dig holes and plant them? They just blow in and grow. Yeah, and you see the package says put an inch deep?
Yep.
How stupid, it takes us longer to come up. I did the quarter inch and up in a week. You know, I'm just so much. See all the stuff we're told. Look at this. Look at the beautiful greens. Look at these nice row of carrots. See, that's gonna feed me all winter. You know, just look at the color of the stuff. You know, it's just like, and it's simple. It's, you know, never, no preparation. If I want to plant, I can do it. Yes.
How did you get from that hard pack to this? Yeah.
I put the covering and walked away.
For how long?
Immediately it changes, and here's why.
Okay.
As soon as water goes through this, it creates compost tea.
Okay.
Are you aware of compost tea today?
Yeah.
Compost tea is the most expensive, desirable fertilizer on the planet.
Okay.
People are buying it like crazy because it works. It's powerful. And I just laugh. As soon as you put covering on the ground, water going through it creates tea and fertilizes the plant. You know what's so cool about God? He's just so genius. I love him. Ever notice when God fertilizes? When does God fertilize?
Fall.
Fall. Every fall, the Creator puts a covering of needles and leaves over the whole planet. when the farmers fertilize in spring.
Right.
How stupid. God does it in fall, and then he follows that with rain and snow that carries compost tea into the soil to build the soil for next spring's growth.
Right.
Fertilizing the spring is not going to get the roots in time. Duh! You know, and then he uses gravity to help him so he doesn't have to do any work. Because gravity, everything goes down, so as water lays on the wood chips as they're composting, it creates compost tea and feeds the soil. So everything you see here is getting compost tea 24/7 for free. As soon as you buy compost tea and you put it in, as soon as you water it, two or three waters, it's down below the roots and it's gone. So you just lost all your fertilizer. Or with a covering, every time it rains, you get more. So the plants have a constant source of life. You know what's so cool about this? See, God's not static. Is that every year my produce gets bigger and sweeter because more is going into the soil than the plants can take out. I love that. And the beauty is I'm doing nothing, yes.
You never use a full cover crop.
No.
Good.
Because he's planting in the fall.
Because I told you to.
So in the fall, do you put wood chips on this, a small layer?
Yeah.
Well, if I have time, that's the ideal time. In my chicken pen, you'll see that the chickens are making so much, I'm being forced to take it out.
Okay, so you put that out here.
So I have to because they're making too much. See, at all levels, I'm being pushed by abundance. I think this is so fun.
Okay.
I mean, God's awesome. And when you finally connect, he starts really opening your eyes to see. You know, it's just like every day it just gets better. You know, I mean, look at that arugula. I mean, this is September. We just went through a hot summer.
Yeah.
No one has arugula in their garden looking like this. It's all bolted. But you see, under my trees in the shade, I'm growing stuff.
Right.
No one's growing. No farmer. No orchard is growing stuff under the trees because the ground's compacted and hard, full of weeds and roots and surface. Look at this beautiful stuff under my tree. You don't see that in farms. But to see this shade, this summer has kept this kale totally nice. Look, the arugula is gorgeous because it's shaded. So in the summertime, you know what's so cool about the cover in the winter? This just happened 3 years ago, the kale under here. I'm out thinning my kale in my garden. I just tell you, I love God. He's such a dad. He so loves his kids. I grow kale every year because this feeds me the entire winter. This is all winter long when it's freezing cold, ice on the ground. This Russian kale and that Lhasa kale produces new growth, and I have fresh live greens all winter long, which is awesome. So I'm thinning my kale in the garden. I've always taken the stuff I thin to give my chickens, and God says, go plant those under your cherry tree. And so right away, this is just how brain dead I am, I'm telling God, well, God, you don't plant stuff under trees. It's shaded. It won't grow. I'm telling God. And I just love how his response is, just do it. So I did. That next year, I've been here for 34 years. That next fall, we had this incredible mild fall, didn't get cold. And we had this cold front come in from Alaska, and it got down to 8 degrees. I have been here for 34 years. The coldest I've ever seen is like 17. At 8 degrees, all the kale that I've been eating for 20 years in my garden totally died, was completely frozen and gone. But the kale in my tree, because the protection, the covering of the tree, didn't die. And then I'm watching in the winter when it snowed, and the kale in my garden always got flattened out. But under the tree, when the snow would hit the tree, it'd break the fall, and it all stood up. I'm planting kale in my cherry tree for the rest of my life. Because no matter what the winter does, I'm going to have live food. And you see, my dad, who knew what was coming up that next year, told me.
Yeah.
I just love it. He's such and here's the word you see three times in Scripture that no one gets. First in Proverbs and twice in Hebrews, today is very present tense. Today, if you'll hear his voice, harden not your heart. And see, we have this, I know what I'm doing, God. Don't tell me. I got plans. I got agendas. And we don't listen. But he's always there telling us what to do, trying to guide us and provide for us.
Right.
We shut him off. If you'll hear my voice. It's so pathetic. We don't get it.
Paul?
Yes?
You put down maybe 8 inches of this top.
In a garden space, you want to do 4 inches initially.
Oh, 4 inches.
Because initially you got to pull it back and plant in the soil. Because you see, the wood chips are not a growing medium. They're a covering and support to the soil.
Mm-hmm.
And so initially we're going to go in the, or you'll pull the wood chips back and plant the soil. So if you do more than 4 inches, it's a lot of work to pull back. Now in an orchard or where you have blueberries or established plants, you can put as thick as you want because they're already in the ground. But where you're planting little seeds, 4 inches is ideal.
Okay, but you started out with compact earth.
And you put 4 inches over it.
Yeah.
And if you wait a month, You'll pull that witch's back, and the ground underneath it is no longer compact. It's soft and damp.
That's what I wanted to ask.
And you're going to flip out like, what happened? You older folks, when you were growing up, I grew up in Los Angeles, which is a desert. Los Angeles is a desert.
Yeah.
When I was growing up as a child, you never saw any human being anywhere that carried a water bottle. No one ever carried. And it's a desert. It's hot all summer long. No one had a water bottle. Because back in that time, the food had water in it, and you were hydrated with the food you were eating. Mm. Today, the food is so dehydrated, everyone has water. Even though you notice everything you're eating here is full of water. Major water content. Because that's the design. And the reason is because roots could spread out in soft ground and pull up water. Today, because the ground's compacted, I don't care how much you're watering, if there's no root system, it's not going to the plant. That's why farmers are watering their gardens, fields, and things are wilting. I'm going to take you over here and show you a dramatic thing that's going to flip you out. I have a 7-year-old dwarf plum tree that has roots out 30 feet from the trunk.
Oh my gosh.
It's and if you understand dwarf trees, how they develop root dwarf trees is they take a cultivar you want and graft into a rootstock that doesn't develop roots. That's why it stays dwarf, because it doesn't have a large root system, it doesn't get big. Mm. I got a seven-year-old dwarf tree with roots out 30 feet from the trunk. I'm just saying, wow, God, you're awesome. And you see, this is why I never have to water. It's not about the amount of water in the ground, it's the plant's capacity to take it up via a root system. So if you got a root system with a radius, not a diameter, 30 feet, you don't need a lot of water. It's got it's taken up. I mean, it's just so huge. Let's walk over and check it out. That the stem, this thick part, mm-hmm. is going to be bitter. Tough and bitter. Watch this. Now, be honest. If you don't like it, be real.
Well, it's tender and not hard.
Because you don't like it.
The flavor is kind of harsh for me.
Okay. Like I've had kale. Someone here who eats kale regularly?
Gosh,
I do. I do out of my garden.
Hoping my tours can end in October, because that's when the garden kind of dies, but people kept coming all year. People coming in January. In the garden to eat food, I didn't have anything but, kale and cilantro. So people were eating my kale, and everyone said this. This is not bitter, this is sweet. Mm-hmm. Everyone. And when I hear something over and over the same thing, I'm kind of sensing that I'm supposed to learn something here. This is not coincidental. So I asked God, I says, God, talk to me. He says, well, I'm not bitter. I've never been bitter. Everything I make is sweet. But the reason it's bitter is because the ground is bitter. And he gave me the word. He says, all of nature is groaning and travailing, waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. The ground is bitter. The soil is bitter. And because the soil is bitter, the plants are bitter. This is everything in nature is clearly revealing what's going on, and we're not getting it. And see, we have adjusted ourselves to eating undesirable, bitter stuff and think that's how it's supposed to be, but it's not. The Creator is good. He made nothing bitter. And because the ground has been abused, it's been depleted. It's minerals that give flavor and vitality to food. Minerals. Minerals is the foundation to all of life. And when minerals are deficient, the food's deficient. When you put this covering down, all the minerals are returned, and everything starts tasting good. And every year it gets better and better and better. It's just so incredible, so wonderful.
So this is pine needles?
Oh, this is fir. This is from a Douglas fir. This is a very recent application.
Okay.
You know, and I just put it here, and and look at that. Move fine. And it keep going. You see how damp it is down there?
Yeah.
And look how soft and beautiful it is?
Perfect.
In the middle of September, and you know why?
Plant them. June, July.
I took them out of my garden. I want all you gardeners to hear me. I planted my garden a row of cucumbers, and if I can find one here, might even be ready. There's a ton more up further, so we'll all get them.
That is incredibly flavorful.
See how
it's incredibly flavorful.
And the skin, how you don't have to peel it.
No.
So anyway,
exactly.
I took my cucumbers out of my garden. And see, when you transplant plants, the book says, take soil with it, and when you move it, give it B1 and water. So I took it out of my ground, completely bare-rooted, left all the soil there. I stuck it in my wood chips with no B1, no water, and this is happening. Mm-hmm. And what's so cool about...
Was it in the soil or was it just in the wood chips?
I just planted in the wood chips. And you see, now all the ones in my garden are starting to get tired and be done. These are just beginning. So this has, instead of having to plant twice, my same planting will extend my whole season way longer than two people's planting.
I love that.
Now, you see this plum tree right here? This is a 7-year-old dwarf plum, right there.
What?
Yeah, right next to that guy.
Oh my God.
You see this
is there a plum
sucker coming out of the ground here? You see this?
Mm. Yeah.
This is the same foliage as that because this is a root sucker coming from that tree.
Wow.
In 7 years, this is 30 feet. This is 30 feet.
Oh my God.
This is that little tree there I planted with all the apples. I planted that in February and I took 30 apples off because the branches were going to break.
What kind of apple is that?
That one there is a Liberty, which is awesome.
Okay.
And I don't know if it's ripe yet, but someone can try one and see.
What did we do wrong?
But look at this, 30 foot. This is not diameter, this is radius.
Right.
In 7 years, on a dwarf tree. Remember they told you in school, the roots go as far out as a drip line.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Yeah.
I love it. Now I want to show you something cool here. God is so awesome. He sent this wheat in here in August. I don't know if it blew in or a bird brought it. I have no idea what it is, but it just came in.
Oh, that's a tree.
This weed.
They have one growing in the driveway.
This thing here, whatever it is, came in August, the 1st of August. Someone want a pear? There's a nice pear there. To pick it up. That's the dog there. Mm. And I want you to notice the beautiful foliage, how delicate it is. Just look at this thing. No bug bites. And this happened at the 1st of August when we hadn't had any rain since the end of June, all through July, no rain. And this thing blew in, landed on these wood dry chips that your brain and all the schools say nothing will grow in. And this is happening? I'm just telling you, man, these are the kind of things that arrest my attention. I can't... yes?
Could have possibly been a seed in the wood chips that you...
No, because they've been here for several years.
Okay.
I think either a bird or a blew-in. I have no idea what it is. It's getting ready to bloom, you know? But it's just been such a pleasure to watch happen and just reveals to me the power of the covering. And let me tell you what's so powerful about the covering. This is why it doesn't need water. Wood chips laying on the ground. Everybody listen to me, this is huge. Wood chips laying on the ground absorb moisture out of the air at night, the mist, the dew, and store it in their cells to release to the plants growing around them. And you know who thought this up? I'm just telling you, man, when you start seeing and getting what got the design, you just stand in awe at the wisdom.
Hydroscopic element.
Yeah.
Takes in water, lets out water.
It's awesome.
Do you think you should water them if you've done the system? I mean, should you do
water? Well, if you saw my film,
yes.
I didn't have water. I had no option.
Correct.
So I had no choice. And these trees have been here now 34 years. They have never been watered or fertilized. And I'm just saying, yay, God.
Yeah.
Yay, God, you're awesome. And I tell you, one of the greatest gifts I ever got was that lousy well. Had I had a good well, you wouldn't be here today, and I wouldn't be even doing this. I can't even hardly walk. But I maintain this entire place in this condition, physically, with this rake. I'm just telling you, I hope you're getting it. This is huge. This is huge. This is not like, you know, maybe okay. This is like over the top awesome.
Yeah.
Let's walk over here and check out these things growing in my orchard. Look at the size of these zucchini plants.
You want us to harvest some of these apples as we go?
You're welcome to, yeah.
Not for us, but for you.
No, I don't need them.
You wait till they fall on the ground.
This is a really cool heirloom zucchini. It's not like those green ones you get. It's really nutty and good. And so on your way out, if somebody wants those, just help yourself. These are growing in my orchard. that I bare rooted out of my garden and stuck in my orchard with no B1, no water, and they're doing this. Look at the size of the leaves. I mean, come on. I mean, you who write a zucchini plant, do you have anything like this in your garden?
In New Jersey for the last couple of years.
Look at the flowers.
We've had practically no zucchini. My zucchini started to grow and it died. I didn't put any fertilizer. Same thing happens to the cucumbers and the pumpkins.
I'm just, you know, I've been gardening for 58 years. I'm not a novice. And we wore out shovels in Los Angeles, hand spading.
Mm-hmm.
Because my dad had boys, he was on by a rotary, and he wanted to learn how to work. And they turned, we wore the shovels, got like totally thin, the blades broke because the ground was so hard. And so I understand, you know, I'm looking at this, I've never seen this in my life when I used to work hard to do it. Mm-hmm. And I just stuck these in my orchard, bare rooted, watch them wilt and almost die and turn into this with no water, no attention. It is wow. It's like, wow.
Holy
and this is what I'm starting to get in my spirit. This is how it's supposed to be. This easy yoke, this light burden, abundance. This is the norm. This is like how it's supposed to be. And look at those beautiful weeds growing. Look how nice and lush and green they are, you know, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Healthy as can be. It's just like, you know, and this is in wood chips that everybody tells you can't grow things in. Ties up nitrogen, make your soil acidic.
Because I haven't done.
Water's not a problem. You can't overwater in this.
Yeah.
Everybody, listen to me. This is what's so cool about the covering. No matter where you're living, no matter what the water content is, it's not an issue. Just down the road from us, 70 miles, we have a rainforest. Mm. The whole rainforest.
The Olympic.
The whole rainforest gets 14 feet, not 14 inches. 14 feet of annual rainwater. Now, in your mind, picture a pool of water 14 feet deep and dump that on the ground. That's what it'll look like. If you saw my film, those girls that are filming and are out in that forest walking on this kind of stuff just like this, and it's not boggy and it's not wet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Excuse me? Mm-hmm. I want you to track with me the genius of this creator. This inanimate object has the capacity to displace, to bring to the surface and evaporate 14 feet of annual rainwater, and at my place, when there's no water, it retains it? Awesome. Excuse me? I mean, I don't know about you, but my brain racks at that. This is an inanimate object. It has no mind, and when there's too much water, it displaces it, wicks it out, and evaporates it, and when there's not enough, it retains it? you just gotta stand in awe. If you notice, you don't see one leaf anywhere on these wood chips. I love leaves. I would love to have all my apple leaves stay here and become compost. We get winter winds that blow through here 40 miles an hour. I see my neighbor's got a windmill over there. This is there for a reason. It blows here. All my leaves are history. They're off my property. Can't even find my pasture. But the wood chips don't move. Mm. You want to hear something dramatic? Powerful? Dirt is heavier than wood chips considerably. You pick up both?
Oh, yeah.
When dirt gets dry and the wind blows, what happens to it? It's gone. Wood chips, which are lighter, don't move. Excuse me? I'm just telling you, man. I'm sitting here. These are the things that just flip me out. Like, wow, God. You're really a genius. And it's just like, and you know what's so cool about, you know, I do potatoes. When you grow potatoes, they have to hill dirt over them because they expose right. themselves. I don't hill in my wood chips because the wood chips are light and they lift. And they don't fall off.
Plus they can go down too, right?
You know, I'm just telling you, this covering is so incredible, the design. It's just like, awesome. And here we, as intelligent human beings, go to school and read books and don't get it. Rip it off, till the ground, do all this stuff and go backwards and never get it when it's all out there in front of us just to observe and get. It's just, I mean, it's so cool.
Hey, Paul?
Yes?
You were just talking about your potatoes. Can you explain your process for planting and harvesting?
Yeah. Potatoes, by the way, for all of you here, we're living in times that aren't really stable. And for survival food, that would be the first of the list because it'll feed you the whole year and it's powerful food. In spite of what they're telling you in books, it's incredible food when it's growing well. The reason why it's not good, and everybody listen to me, don't you dare buy any root vegetable from the store. Root vegetables today are loaded with heavy metals and poison. Because farmers who use chemical fertilizers and herbicides intentionally plant carrots, beets, potatoes to clean their fields up of the heavy metals so they can grow stuff. The root vegetables pull everything out of the ground and they store it in their tissue, the roots. So all root vegetables are loaded with all the what's ever in the ground. And when it's heavy metals, that's what's there. So don't buy any root vegetable in the store because it's totally poisonous. So when they do potatoes, the farmers will till deep because they have to because they're planting deep. Then as the potato grows, they have to water because the ground dries out. And then they have to hill dirt over it. And then next year they got to plant something else because if they plant in the same place, they become scabby and not usable. I've been planting potatoes in the same place now for 26 years, the same potatoes. And my approach is so cool. I get on my ground, and I wish I could do it because it's so fun to watch. I just, with my hands, I pull the plant up with my hands. No tool, it's not poking holes in it, because the ground moves. With my hands, I move the woods and take out these gorgeous, clean potatoes because they weren't even dirt. They're not dirty. They're clean. And so when I get to the bottom of the hole, I take my very biggest and best potato. Are you hearing me? The biggest and the best, and put back in the bottom of the hole, and I cover it, and I plant it and harvest the same day.
Just the whole potato.
The whole potato. And here's why. You were told, and he just brought it up, he's saying the whole potato, because you were told to cut potatoes and plant small pieces.
And put the eye, one eye in.
You know the insanity of that? You see, this is why we were given an owner's manual, and we're not paying attention to it. In the owner's manual, we're told the importance of giving the best back. The Israelites, when they came to Israel, God says, if you'll give me first fruits every year, I'll bless you. It's the same in agriculture. If you put your very biggest and best back, you get more. Do the math. When a potato grows, it grows shoots out from the little eyes that are in it. So the more eyes you have, the more shoots you get. As the potato grows, it's feeding on the potato. So if you put the biggest back, the more eyes, the more you're going to get more back. The math is very simple. But we went to school, and we had our minds erased so we don't think, and we do what we're told. It's insanity. You know, people look at my garlic and says, where do you get garlic? Well, I plant my biggest back ever. I take my very best and plant my very best seeds, my biggest whatever. I take seed from that and plant back. Duh, first fruits.
Yeah.
Again, it's all given to this owner's manual. And if you go to school, you get your mind erased and you don't even think. And so what's so cool about that, I mean, I did my harvesting planting in several minutes. It was all fun. And I'm done for the rest of the year. I won't water. I won't hill. I'll do nothing. Next year, I harvest. It's just so fun.
And this is in wood chips, or this is in composed?
In wood chips.
Decomposed
chips. And then if I feel my place is getting decomposed and broken down, in the fall, I'll add a layer over that stuff I planted so I have a good covering. Every fall is the ideal time to add.
Okay.
Because things do break down, and so I'll add some more. But what's so cool is I'm planting in the same place now. I bought potatoes 26 years ago. I have 7 children who are all adults now, healthy, good, you know, children, adults. I've been feeding for 26 years. I'm still eating the same potatoes. And you see, this shows the nature of God. And he tells you right there in Genesis that he says, all the food I made for you, vegetables and fruits, bear seed after their own kind. And that just shows his heart. He's so generous. Once you have food with semi-diligence, you will have free food for the rest of your life because it produces seed after its own kind. And see, that's why hybrid and genetically modified is totally anti-God, totally diabolic, because they did not produce seed after one kind, and once you have those, then you're subject to those people to get seed.
Right.
And you're cut off from God. I'm just telling you, man, we gotta wake up. The spirit realm is reality, you know. And this is, you see, that thing's full of seed. So I'll let get the very biggest one I have, and I'll collect seed from it and plant it back every year, you know?
Going back to potatoes real quick. Because you plant and harvest the same day. When's the first time that you can go out and grab a newly grown potato, and when's the last time?
Depending on the variety, reds, you can do it very quickly. And as soon as the potato blooms, as soon as you get a flower, you can start harvesting. They'll be small, but you can harvest then. Now, the red ones happen really quick. And if you don't get after them, they'll get so big and they'll get hollow, you can't even use them. So you got to use them quick. But the other, some varieties will take longer. So depending on the variety, depends on how quick you can harvest. But as soon as a potato blooms, you can start harvesting.
And then when do you stop harvesting them? So like, can I pick them in February?
You could. Now I kind of like things in February. I don't go out in the cold. So like I put all mine and all in boxes. So I usually harvest by now. Have them all out so they're in boxes accessible. But you can leave them in the ground all year. They're fine. If you all notice that nothing in nature ever dies in the winter, I don't care where you live. 40 below zero on the East Coast, you know, Canada. Nothing in nature ever dies in the winter. Nothing. But next to nature, everybody's farms, everything freezes. Because the covering's been removed. This material is an insulator. Are you getting God?
So none of your stuff dies in the winter?
I eat food out of my garden the whole year. People come to me, what do you eat in the wintertime? I look at them, answer your own question, what animals eat in the wintertime? Because everything in nature is growing fine in the winter. Excuse me? But you see, this is an insulator. This insulates the ground. And all winter long, I have live food in my garden. I have for greens, cilantro, parsley, lacinato kale, Russian kale, live fresh greens all winter. I have root vegetables, beets, carrots, rutabagas, all winter long. And it was so hilarious in the winter. I had this organic farmer. It was so scary. I mean, I was blown away. An organic farmer from Ontario, Canada, comes here in January. He's out in my garden. And he looks at my carrots and says, oh, you can't eat those. And I says, yeah, I can't eat them. I eat them every day. I says, pull one from me. I says, you can't pull it because, you know, because it's big. You pull it up. So he bends over and he braces something. He almost fell over because it came out so easy. He looks at it. He's flipping out. He says, look at this thing. He says, eat it. He says, I never in my life had a carrot this sweet. Because you see, in the wintertime, when the ground freezes, the sugar content comes up. And so your carrots in the winter are so much sweeter than the summer ones. And you know who thought this up? God knew there wouldn't be a lot in the winter, so he just makes them sweeter. I'm just telling you, if we just connect, it's so awesome, his goodness. And his design is so perfect. And see, all these colored things, you know, the seasons are so critical. Things, you should only eat food fresh in season. Only. Did you hear me? Can I tell you something? You guys, all of you are pretty affluent, well off. You live the most boring, funky life on the planet. Excuse me? You all buy the same garbage from the stores, dead food, and then you bring it home and put it in your refrigerator and let it die further, and then you cook it and kill all the enzymes. And you eat the same junk every week, year round. Go buy the same stuff all the time. I go out here in the spring and my strawberries are coming out in April, and like I have several handfuls, and I just can't believe the flavor. I'm just like, wow. Just as I'm getting used to those strawberries, my raspberries come in. Like, wow, this is a whole other element. Like, whoa. Just as I'm getting used to those, the blueberries happen. Then the plums. Then the pears. Then the apples. And then next year, it does it again. So all year long, I have these incredible, awesome flavors and just incredible joy at really eating. I never go to the house. I don't use any silverware. I have no dishes to wash. You know. I'm telling you, man, it's just, and I'm starting to get, this is how we're supposed to live. And can I connect you to the words of Jesus? On the Sermon on the Mount, he wants us to reconnect, and he says this. Consider the birds of the air, and he could include all the animals, because they didn't fall, they didn't separate. They don't sow, they don't reap, they don't store food in barns, but your Heavenly Father takes care of them. And then he poses a question to get our attention. He says, aren't you of more value than them? What he's trying to say is, I planned on taking care of you all the same way. You disconnected. And do the math. Mm-hmm. Animals are totally relaxed, no stress, they carry no health insurance, don't go to doctors, have no stove, no refrigerator, and live abundant good lives. Because they eat everything fresh in season. You want to hear the science that's scary? Scientific fact is that in 10 minutes after fruits and vegetables are picked, not 10 hours, 10 minutes after fruits and vegetables are picked, they lose up to 80% of their metabolic properties in 10 minutes. And that's why God, when he created Adam and Eve, did not issue them a stove and refrigerator. Excuse me? He did not issue them a stove and refrigerator. We were never designed to eat dead, cooked food. Ever. And if you remember, and if you notice when we get back, when Jesus comes back and when he puts it back like it was, It says everyone will be under their own vine and under their own fig tree. We're all going back to the garden because we should have never left. That was the initial design. It was perfect. And it's how we're supposed to live. It's how it's going to be for the next 1,000 years. So just get ready for it and get used to it because this is our future. Yeah. Live food, fresh in season. Let me just tell you some of the wisdom of the live food. Asparagus is an incredible food. When does asparagus show up in the garden?
March, April.
What did March, April follow? Winter. What did March, April follow? A winter when you had no greens.
Right.
Excuse me? Your body is craving greens and you're out in your garden ready to plant because you're hungry for greens. Your body's saying, I need greens. And asparagus just pops out of the ground and you start eating it. Ever notice when you go to the bathroom after you've had asparagus? The urine odor is so overwhelming. Nothing does that with asparagus. It's like, whoa, I had asparagus. I mean, you can't miss it. I mean, it's there. Are you hearing me? Everybody get it? Well, you know why? Asparagus sends roots into the ground 15 feet. Not inches, 15 feet. They're pulling up minerals that no other produce on the planet ever touches. They are the most mineral-rich produce that exists. And you know when God has it show up? In March, April, when you're the most mineral deficient. You think that's a coincidence, an accident? Let me tell you another cool one. You older folks that are here, when you were growing up, track with me, no one anywhere had skin cancer. I live in Los Angeles where it was hot. We're getting sunburned all the time, major exposure to the sun. No one had skin cancer when I was a kid. No one. Because back in that day, everyone ate tomatoes that were growing fresh in season outside. Are you hearing me? All tomatoes were growing outside in full sun. They did a test on tomatoes, outside grown tomato in full sun, and they examined it. They found 300 phytochemicals in a sun-ripened tomato, and explaining how they work. A tomato skin is no thicker than yours. You look at that tomato, it takes direct sunlight, 100 degrees plus all day long, and it never blisters. It's totally smooth and gorgeous. Beautiful skin. Well, there's a phytochemical in that tomato that protects the skin from blistering. The same tomato they grew in a greenhouse, they tested it. It only had 50 phytochemicals. 250 were lost with light going through glass because it interrupted photosynthesis. Today, skin cancer is rampant because everyone are eating tomatoes that are growing out inside of greenhouses. And the insanity of eating tomato in January, there's no sun. You don't need it. Tomato is a nightshade. It's not good for you all year. God only has, you know, God has it ripened. It's in August, September when the sun's the hottest. And you need the most protection, you think that's a coincidence? An accident? I'm just telling you, man, it's huge. And see, people are eating tomatoes in January. They taste totally bland, totally worthless. And they're buying them. Completely unnecessary, not needed. And you see, when you live in a climate that's not hot, tomatoes don't grow there. Because you don't need the protection. You think there's an accident here? I'm just telling you, when you start connecting and start observing what God does, you're like, wow. The design is so perfect, and when you alter it and change it, it's only negative and degrading. It's incredible.
You've had this dirt here this for been, 37 years.
34 years.
Okay.
So all right. This is what I'm getting. Look at that one over there. I had to stake up, but look at that. That's a Honeycrisp. Look at all the apples on it. That was planted in February. Wow. That tree was planted in February. For those of you who got here late, you see this corn right here? I live in a place that they say if corn is not knee-high by 4th of July, everybody hear me, if it's not knee-high by 4th of July, you won't get corn. So I planted this by seed on the 4th of July. In the middle of my orchard, amongst all this shade, it's just fun. It's just totally a ball. Just like...
So it doesn't matter whether you plant east, west, north, south?
I'm just finding, I'm not having
matter.
Any issues.
It doesn't matter.
I was raised by a Swiss German culture. I see that German part of me just kind of enjoys doing things. Say you can't. It's just kind of like, yeah.
Like your rice?
It's just, I'm going to plant rice over here in my wood chips next year.
Rice?
White rice in the wood chips with no water, and it's going to thrive. Because I'm growing wasabi. In wood chips with no water and thriving.
Now where is that wasabi?
Wasabi is down there underneath my cherry tree in the pond, by the pond.
Oh, by the pond.
And you see out here in the middle of my orchard, you see my beautiful
parsley.
Parsley, and you see the nice cucumbers over there.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the middle of the orchard. This is not
spinach here, right?
This is cilantro and beets, and there's a green over there. And let's walk over here and check out the garden. This is kind of nice.
What do you do with the wasabi?
Wasabi, I'm.
That'll go.
Wasabi. I'm just eating the foliage now because it's a tender plant. I was told 8 years ago that the growers get anywhere from $90 to $120 a pound for the roots.
Yes.
Because it's supposed to be hard to grow.
Right.
Well, it's not hard to grow, and right now I'm just developing it because it's becoming a great ground cover down there for me. And I'm just eating the foliage, and it's so nice in the salads because it's kind of tart and nice. As you walk by here, these green beans are really good. Help yourself and eat them. They're really nice. They're delicious, you know, just raw. Again, remember, you're not supposed to cook stuff. Just see how good this is. Just get in here and pick these green beans. Just sample stuff.
Thank you.
Thank you, God.
Alrighty. Now, are you noticing those apples are pretty good?
Yeah. Delicious. What's the name of it again?
Akane. It's from Japan.
Akane.
What about that pear tree that was right, kind of straight over there on the other side of the corn, where the pears are kind of coming down oblong? That isn't a bosque, is it?
No, I don't know what the name of it is. That's a bosque right here. I bought it. It was mislabeled, and I wish I knew the name because it's an awesome pear.
Is it okay?
I have no idea the name. I have.
Is this your cabin here?
Yeah.
Well, how come it's way up tall?
Well, I don't
Paul,
know.
Would you like a jacket?
Is that just a variety, or did you do something?
I wish. This is just how it grows.
Mine is usually really close to the ground.
Now the whole idea of thinning, you know, carrots and beets. I want you to notice my beets in there, the size, and look how close they are.
Whoa.
Everybody get in there and just check out the density. And you see, this is the beauty of the cover because the ground is so soft, they just move themselves out of the way. You never have to thin anything.
Wow.
And if anybody, you know, wants to, on your way out, take these beets, are really good to eat. Look at the size of them. It's still fine.
So you
see, when I plant, all I plant is my seeds a quarter inch
right
deep.
Here, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And you can see how nice everything's growing.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the size of those feet. Yeah, you can still have the big wood chips like here.
This is also my chickens.
Oh, this is the chicken. Okay.
Everybody, pick some cilantro because it's really good. This is, I don't know if you know the time of year, but this is the end of summer. And I want you to walk in here and check out this incredible broccoli.
Oh my gosh.
Look at these heads of broccoli here.
Wow.
Oh,
ours
is
awesome. Oh my goodness.
What are these traps?
Man, mine are long.
Oh, we'll try to get them all. Now.
Okay, good. We have them all on the
plate.
Excuse me.
Now cilantro, when it bolts, everybody listen to me here. That's no good. That's lousy. It's too old. Come here. See, when something bolts, it's going to seed, it's tough and bitter. I want someone to try this out at the base, eat your way back and talk about it.
Nothing at all bitter about it.
Oh!
He just said it's bitter to me.
Yummy!
Cilantro is one of has the highest vitamin C content of any plant that grows. No citrus has near the vitamin C that cilantro has. And cilantro, you should all be eating it because it's really good. It's delicious. And I want you to notice the difference compared to the store-bought. Yeah, just snap off a leaf and eat it.
It's
cilantro is also a natural chelator. It takes heavy metals out of your body. And you see the creator designed this on the third day because he knew we'd be dealing with that today. I'm just telling you, it's incredibly huge, the design of nature and how all these foods are just so totally amazing. Now, for you gardeners, I want to show you how nice it is to weed in this stuff.
You know, I've grown cilantro, but it bolts really fast.
Well, even when it bolts,
it doesn't last that long.
Well, keep planting. see that cilantro over there? That's going to replace this. Right there is cilantro. See it?
Okay.
So I just keep planting. Yeah. I'll get like 7 plantings a year.
Oh, really? Okay.
Now, for you gardeners who weed, everybody come out here, I want to show you something cool. I have a few weeds here.
Mm-hmm.
Right where you're standing. Now, I want you to watch how we weed in the garden here. Watch this.
Hey.
Is that cool?
That's cool.
Is that cool?
That's cool.
I mean, come on. I was on my knees weeding my whole life as a kid, and it wasn't like that. I'm just, these are the kind of things that just blow. Look at that. Just take your, look at it. They're gone. Wow. History. All with the rake, and you don't have to bend over.
Beautiful.
I'm just telling you, man, this is the benefits just don't end.
It's supposed to be hard, though, Paul.
Huh?
It's supposed to be hard.
No, it's not. He says, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. The hard came with the fall, the separation. Remember he told Adam, by the sweat of your brow, you're disconnected because you're disconnected. Right. It wasn't that way in the garden. That was a disconnect. It was not by design. It was not by design. And I'm going to show you over here in a minute why man began to till the soil, because it makes no sense. When I saw how simple this was, I'll just tell you, you know, you see those wood chips out there?
Yeah.
You saw that stuff growing in it? Especially you men. If I were to tell you on the street, come over here. You see these wood chips over here? You can have a great garden here. You'd think I was nuts. If I told you you could plant a great garden and that kind of stuff, I just had wood chips, you says, you're crazy. You gotta have dirt. You gotta have dirt to grow stuff in. Here's why man began tilling the ground. Because when Adam was in the garden, he saw how God did it. He understood how to do it right. Why, when he got put out of the garden, did he start ripping the cover off, exposing dirt? I'm asking God. You know, I told him it was huge. When God created Adam and Eve, he created them like himself. He said, let us create man in our own image, after our own likeness. God is a spirit. You hearing me? God created Adam and Eve as spirit beings. And as spirit beings, they related everything from the spirit realm. And that's why they weren't naked. Because the body was the clothing for the spirit. And they weren't naked. They were totally clothed. The body clothed the spirit. When they sinned, I love the wording in the scripture, it says their eyes were opened. It didn't mean they were blind. They made a shift of consciousness from the spirit realm to the natural mind. And from the natural mind, they realized, well, we're not covered. We're naked, we're exposed. So they got fig leaves to cover themselves. When man looks at the covering in nature, from the natural mind, he says, well, you can't grow stuff in this, you gotta have dirt. And because he can't believe in faith in the spirit for what he can't see, he takes the covering off so he can see the dirt. He has to see it. I'm telling you, it's huge. It's huge. He has to see the dirt. So he takes the covering off and tills it so he can see the dirt, because he can't believe for what he can't see. I tell you, you can grow a garden. No way, you gotta have dirt, because you can't believe for what you can't see. It's huge. It's like, wow, mind blowing.
Do you have a rule of thumb as to how far you plant your rows apart?
I used to plant them 3 feet apart, but you can see them having problems here.
Yeah.
But you know what's so cool about God? I mean, you see my cilantro. This is September. We had a really warm summer this year, and cilantro would bolt like crazy. But the shade from the zucchini has been shading my cilantro, so it's not bolting so quick. So I started, and this was accidental from the natural. I didn't plan on this, but God's just saying, you see this? You should do this kind of stuff. This works. So if you're just paying attention, you're going to see him reveal and show you things in the garden that just blow you away, like, what a great idea. That's awesome. That, you know, and again, you're just, this is why he put us in the garden up front, to have a relationship, and we should have never left. He's always there. He always shows up in the garden, and he always is showing cool things. If you just pay attention, just get it. You know?
What about raised mounds?
Raised mounds are a challenge because they dry out very quick. Anything above grade, boxes are going to water like crazy because they expose in the air. And see, people do mounds and boxes because the ground's miserable beyond. If you notice, this is not miserable. It's very comfortable. When you get on your knees, you don't get muddy. Your feet are never muddy. It's never hard, so it's not an undesirable surface to work on. Where in a dirt soil, it's miserable, so you do raised beds to get off the dirt. Well, this is not necessary. Guy doesn't do raised beds. He just grows things flat on the ground just fine.
Was this originally like the wood chips, and then you just put the chicken on?
Yeah, okay. I did. Don't you dig. No, okay. You can't dig. I understand it's soft and it's pleasant, but you can't dig. I don't blame you, but you just, no digging in the garden. Get out. Kirza, get out. Now, this covering not only affects stuff you grow in the garden, it affects anything you grow. Is anybody here aware of Japanese maple trees?
Yeah.
Are you? Yeah. You know, Japanese maple trees are really delicate and small. They don't get big. I want to show you Japanese maple. It's going to blow your mind. Remember, you see in Japan, because it's a small place, they don't have room for trees to get big, so they design stuff that's say miniature. Let me show you one here that's going to blow you away. Just to show you the power of the covering, is just, you know. See, again, my challenge is trying to stop things to grow, not to make them grow. Go work it out. It's good for
them. So, how many inches of the chicken?
Well, you can see my
picture. You can see my grass there?
Yeah.
Not very much.
Really? Just that much? Mm-hmm. And so it was just cleared. You put the newspaper
down? I have wood
down.
Chips under it. No, this is after years of wood chips got it woke me up to see.
Okay.
See, all you,
okay.
See, everything in my garden, you guys, everybody listen to me. Everything in my garden is maintained from my yard waste.
Okay.
My yard waste. See, yard waste, my grass clippings, all my weeds, all my expired plants, see those big old broccoli, see those big old cabbage plants, that would be a nightmare to deal with that. I take all that to my chickens, including the ashes out of my stove and all the stuff out of the kitchen, I take it all to them, who produce wonderful eggs, and they turn it back into that stuff. And they do it all. If you guys have you know, compost piles you always turn, you don't get anything that nice.
Yeah.
And the chickens do it all for free. Everything. I put it all in the chickens. We're going there. You're going to see it.
Oh, perfect.
It's all there.
Okay,
and you're going to see what an incredible job they do. But before we go there,
they're little cultivators, aren't they? They're always digging.
I refer to my chickens as my soil manufacturing plant. I have 20 now. I like to have about 30. It's like I produce a lot of material. Here, let's walk over. I want to show you this maple tree. You got to.
So you carry all your old plants that have already produced over to your chickens?
Everything goes there.
Oh.
Everything from my ashes from the stove, stuff out of the kitchen, everything goes to the chicken coop. I want you to notice here, behind this clothesline, in amongst my fir trees in total shade, I want you to notice this Japanese maple tree that's 12 years old.
Oh, that tree.
Look where it's growing. It's growing underneath trees that get sun. And it's supposed to grow in full sun.
Right here.
They're supposed to grow in full sun.
Oh my goodness.
I planted it here because I wanted a small tree. But I made the mistake of putting wood chips over it. You can see the wood chips have all settled and all the roots at the top. Look at the size of that wood. Look at the height of it. This is a 12-year-old Japanese maple. It's not supposed to get big. 12 years old. I'm an arborist. I prune trees for a living. I do Japanese maples. I never use a more than an 8-foot ladder. I gotta use a 12-foot ladder to get in this thing.
None of the leaves are green and yellow on that tree, I tell you that.
I'm just telling you, these are the kind of things that arrest my attention. I can't miss this. I know God does this kind of stuff to get my attention, like, hey, you want to see who I am? This is how I do stuff, you know? Now, I want you all, any of you here think you have soil that's kind of hard to work with? Hard, compacted clay, difficult soil? I want you to introduce you to my soil over here. See my soil?
Mm-hmm.
This is the soil that everything you walked on and ate from is growing in. And again, you know, I'm going to break my rake if I try to cultivate this. This is my soil. And everything there, and what I want you to get is that God's not challenged by anything. There's nothing that challenges, and if you put the cover down, everything below gets changed. I love that.
What did you put instead of the 4 inches? I really think that I might have got more like 6 to 8 inches.
That's fine, but initially you got to pull it back to get to the soil to plant your seeds.
It was hard. I bought some supposedly organic seedlings and planted
them.
I'm glad you.
Here's a difficulty about seedlings. Everybody listen to me, this is huge.
Okay.
You've all gone to the store and you look at these gorgeous plants they want to sell you in the spring.
Yes.
Beautiful, healthy, beautiful, lush. And as soon as you plant them in your garden, and no matter what garden it is, as soon as you plant them, they stand still and go backwards.
Mm-hmm.
They don't grow. Here's why. They are grown in sterile environments. Peat moss, vermiculite, perlite is all sterile.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing grows in it. And they fed them chemical fertilizers to make them grow.
Oh,
and they had them in a warm, protected place. When they came to the real world, they just stopped. You can take, I've taken those plants and planted a seed next to it and watched the seedling totally pass it up and make it dwarf it. Because they were never created.
Do you ever do?
The only thing I start here because of where I live, I do hot peppers and tomatoes.
Okay.
But I grow them in organic stuff, and before I plant them for several weeks, I bring them out every day and hard them off to the weather so that they're sturdy.
Okay.
See, that stuff's been in a totally protected environment, raised on sterile material, and when it hits the real world, it just stops.
Yeah.
And you're wasting your money. Just plant seeds in season, and they'll do fine. And so it's so pathetic because it looks so nice when you bought it, and it just goes backwards. And so it's very depressing to you as a gardener, like, what's up with this, you know? Let's check it. Walk over here. I'm going to show you my herb garden and the chicken pens. And I'm sorry, I didn't order the rain, but
not supposed to rain and squim.
But the brown saying thank you though. Everything else except us is loving the rain.
Yeah. Well, what kind of tree is this to your right?
This is a willow, a native willow.
Oh,
right here.
Wow, it's beautiful, the shape and everything.
And if you notice, it has no trunk.
Yeah.
The trunk's all rotten.
Uh-huh.
But I love the bend. And when my kids were growing up, it was standing high enough that one of the neighbor kids broke their arm.
Uh-huh.
But it's totally rotten now. But I love the shape, because I keep working with it, trying to keep it alive.
Wow, it is beautiful.
It's a native willow.
Oh, wow. It's beautiful. I love the trunk.
And I want you to notice here some fig trees.
Oh,
I grow in a place where you can't grow figs. I'm serious. This is Western Washington. I'm 600 feet above sea level, and I've been eating wonderful figs off these.
Mm-hmm.
And all these trees I started from a stick in the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Stick. I can take a cutting from that. And if you guys want them later on, you know, after they go, I can give you a stick in the ground. And this is the only variety that gets ripe here. It's called Desert King, and I get ripe figs every year.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I want you to notice this arborvitae. You guys ever see these in people's yards?
Yes.
They look funky on the outside, and the whole inside is all brown.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Open those up and check them out.
Huh.
You're fine.
There's no brown in there. There's no spiders either.
Oh, that is,
yeah.
And these are only like 10 years old. They're young. And you know why they're here? See, the kind of, God is just really, he's a good dad, and he likes to get our attention if we're just open up. I was doing a landscape with someone. I did a whole, I wanted to roll these for privacy, so this came in the group, and it's a double leader. There's two in one, and I couldn't use it. But I paid for it, so I'm going to throw it away. So I stuck it here to get rid of it.
Mm-hmm.
This has been totally ignored. No attention. And God keeps telling, are you watching this? And the ones you planted where they have an irrigation system and fertilizing are one-third of this size. They're all brown inside, look funky. And this, in wood chips, is doing no attention, looks like this. This is only 10 years old.
Yeah.
You don't see them this big in this color.
Uh-huh.
And this is an accident. This was like, I'm trying to get rid of it. Get out of my way. You look over there at those leeks growing in my wood chips.
Yeah.
Look at the size of those, the color.
They are gorgeous. Those are leek. Yeah.
Now, I'm sorry it's raining, but I want you all to... Does anybody grow strawberries?
Yes.
Yeah.
Does anybody have strawberries in the ground now that look like these?
No.
No.
Well, let me tell you why.
Whoa,
this is huge. Look at the color of the foliage this time of year.
Right.
And if someone wants a real treat, take a bite of this fennel while I'm talking to you. You're going to be shocked at the flavor. It's delicious. strawberries are a labor-intensive plant to grow.
Right.
You send these runners out, and when you first plant your bed, they produce well, and then over time they get really dense because they can't. And it's a nightmare to get the old ones out because they're covered by young ones. So you're in there thinning, and it's just a ton of work. So I'm out with God, say, you know, God, you says your yoke is easy, your burden is light. This is not. How would you approach it? He says, every fall, cover the whole strawberry bed with witches. Just bury it.
What?
Bury the whole strawberry bed with witches. Just cover the whole thing. Bury it. Hide it. And here's the beauty and the genius of God. See, it doesn't take a lot either, because watch this. See how it lays down? So it didn't take much to cover. So when I put the wood chips over this, all these leaves under the wood chips become compost and feed the plants. And here's the genius of God. In the spring, out of the ground, you don't even know it's there anymore, come pushing through the wood chips, totally staggered, just the young, healthy plants. The old ones under the wood chips rot and become compost because they can't push through the wood chips. It's too much work. And if you look at these are all young plants. Now this van, I want you to walk. Just walk on top of my strawberries like they're, just walk on them hard. Step hard. I mean, hard, go for it. You see, he's having no impact. Nothing's getting broken because under the wood chips, it's all buoyant, full of air, and nothing's damaged.
I'm 6 inches deep right here. It's soft.
Every fall. I would do it pretty soon. I'm leaving this here because it looks so good just for these tours. And I want you to notice over here. See my strawberries over there? Notice I'm growing strawberries under my trees in shade. The book says plant in full sun. Are you starting to get the advantage? You see, all your places that you couldn't use under the wood chips are available. So instead of taking up space, you can grow other stuff. Plant under your tree strawberries. Great ground cover. I have no weeds. I never water. It's always a pleasure to look at. Feeds you well. And you can do it in places where they say you can't.
You fully bury them every year?
Every year. And that's why they're all young plants. You see, there's no old ones here. Because the old ones became compost under the wood chips. And I didn't have to thin. I'm thinking it takes 20 minutes compared to hours of thinning.
Where is that documented?
Can I tell you something? You will never find this in a book.
Right.
No human mind will come up with this. This came from the Creator. I ask. And come on. He's just awesome. And he says you have not because you asked that. We don't ask. And we've got to wake up and start doing it.
Is there any special time of day or night that you ask?
I do. There's no time I don't anymore. All day long, I'm just we're talking all the time. Says God. Well, look over here.
You don't just ask him. You got to listen also.
Huh? Oh, you're so welcome. But look at how beautiful this is. Just enough to bury it. Just to get it out of sight. And then all winter long, you can walk on it. You don't know what's there. Because your strawberries in the winter are ugly looking. They're all, you know, dark, ugly leaves, funky. You don't even see them. And then in the spring, it's just so exciting. Like, they come pushing. Wow, the strawberries are coming. And then I wish you were here when they were ripe. They're just so huge and so delicious. Like, and then I have no weeds, and I've never watered this. And you want to hear something awesome? This bed here, and I've given boxes to people because they grow so well, was 3 plants 4 years ago.
Oh.
Yes. And I've given boxes because they keep sending runners out taking my path. Now, I want you to come over here and look at my blueberries. My 7-year-old blueberry plant.
Evergreen?
Pruning is an art form.
Evergreen.
And you work from the inside out, and you want to take nothing should be hidden in. Basically, pruning is arrangement where light gets to everything, and there's no crossovers. Stuff should come up and out. And totally open, so that light can light.
But when they weren't doing really old bushes, everything is crossing
the small. Come over here, look at mine. It's over there. See how I've opened it up?
Yeah, but that's...
They're going to come back. Now, I want you all to... These cucumbers here, there's some good ones in it. Eat them. They're all over the place.
And I want you to notice, this is an alkaline-loving plant right next to those blueberries, which are acid. Okay. And they're totally thriving. Eat these. They're awesome. They're good.
Yeah, I know. I feel cucumbers. Bad. This is my second
cucumbers. And this is growing in the same space that blueberries are, which is the totally opposite. Opposite of pH. Yeah. I love it.
Take it home.
And this is what's so cool about God. You see, there's no issue. You can plant anything you want anywhere. Look at my sage, you guys. This is a desert plant. This is sage. Look how beautiful it is. It wants to grow in a desert. So I wish it's just fine. Last year I had watercress out and we planted it again because it just does fine right next to it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just,
where do you get watercress?
Nurses carry. Yeah.
That's
what I love. Well, I mean, my wasabi only grows in standing water.
Yeah.
It's growing in woodchips now for 8 years and with no irrigation. It's just like, it is wild. And I'm getting that. You see, all this stuff they're telling us. God didn't write that in the Bible, you can't grow wasabi in woodchips. That's man coming from a place of default where he took the cover off. It's not God. Yes. Some herb my wife planted. My wife is a midwife, and she uses herbs in her practice, no drugs, and so she has laws of her. I don't know what it is. Does anybody use thyme in her cooking?
Yes.
Thyme. I want you all very carefully to do take a very small piece of this and get ready for a shock of its power. This is going to blow you away how powerful this thyme is.
What is that one?
It's thyme. Let's take a small piece because it's going to shock you. It's powerful. And, this is the effect of minerals.
I know.
Minerals are powerful. Mm-hmm. And you see, all the stuff that you buy in the store has no minerals in the ground.
I know. Oh, my goodness.
It's delicious.
Well, you wouldn't need to use very much of
this. You don't need much. This is telling you this. It's so significant, the difference in store-bought. Now, has anybody been around chicken pens?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They have a very distinct odor.
Horrible.
I want you all to really open up your nasal passages and try to take in the odor here.
Try to take it in, okay.
Well, that's what I noticed is that I couldn't smell it the last time I was here.
Yeah,
let's
talk about pruning blueberries.
About what?
Pruning blueberries, maybe?
Blueberries, yeah.
I think she's
blueberries. That's a good question, though.
Here's a big tree here.
Blueberries. See how I prune them? See how open they are? And they're going to fill right back in. But you see, look over. See how nice and green they're coming in? Look how open. I open them up, and they go, psh. See, pruning is a stimulant. It'll make your plant grow better than anything in the world. No fertilizing will ever compare to pruning.
When do you prune?
When I feel like it. I'm doing everything at a convenient, when I have time and space, that's what I do.
There's figs on that tree. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
There's a fig tree in the middle of the pen.
Now everybody pick up the chicken odor here. Right here.
I don't smell it.
Here's my chicken pen. And I want you to see this awesome soil manufacturing plant I have here. You can see all my yard waste. You look at zucchini, you see they're eating. See, my chickens eat nothing but organic food. My chickens eat better food than most people. You can see all my grass clippings. There's lemon rinds. There's avocado seeds. There's all my wood ashes over there. If you look at the grass outside, you see how much higher it is here? You see how short my fences are getting? I have to every year take out this stuff because they're making so much.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and I will have for the rest of my life everything my garden needs, and all I need is a wheelbarrow and a screen. All from my yard waste.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just telling you, this is what I so love about God. If you start waking up and observing what He's given, everything you need, you look at this gorgeous stuff in there. Look at how beautiful and black it is. It's just rich. And these chickens are making from all, look at my big old nasty broccoli plants and stuff. All that comes in here and they turn it back into that gorgeous black stuff and I do no work.
How come you don't smell a strong manure smell?
The reason there's no strong manure smell, everybody listen to me. Nothing in nature stinks. You can grow in the nature where you have huge flocks of birds and animals. There's no odor. None. God is an awesome God. He's good. He made nothing to stink.
Nothing stinketh.
When something stinks, it's a wake-up call that something is out of order.
Yeah.
I'm just, and we, because we went to school, we have now adapted to and accept stench as normal and live with it.
Yeah.
It's abnormal. It's wrong. It shouldn't be. And when something stinks, it's because the order is not in place.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just telling you, it's huge.
Hey, Paul, what's, do you feed him anything else?
Is this a cougar? What's this?
This is a cat.
Oh, my. Oh. My eyes are going really fast.
That's my cat.
It's
okay. You see how the chickens, how they're constantly digging and picking out? Right. You see, they pick out every weed seed. They're constantly working the soil, you know,
turning it over.
Where you got these compost piles that you're turning and you're doing all this labor. These guys do it all for free. A way better job than you can. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's just so pathetic how we just don't connect, you know. And look at it, you know, eating that onion, you know, zucchini. Yeah, that's an onion.
You don't feed them corn or anything at all?
Again, people ask me, aren't you feeding them grain? And I always ask, you ever see a pheasant in nature or wild turkeys? They're beautiful,
right.
Gorgeous feathers. Who's feeding them grain? Who's feeding them corn? Excuse me? Mm-hmm. Who is feeding them that stuff? No one. Mm-hmm. They get some grain in the summer when the grass goes to seed, but that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the year they're eating just this. And you see, because we went to school and we're told they have to have that because they want to sell you that garbage, we believe it. Mm-hmm. But we don't look at nature. Nature's just telling you just the opposite. And we don't believe it. So my chickens live fine year-round on all my yard, all that kale out in the orchard, that's for my chickens all winter. See, I raise everything here to support them, you know, as well as myself. Mm-hmm. And it's not hard. It's very easy. Mm-hmm. You know what's so interesting about the chickens? The chickens will tell you what is the most nutritious food to eat. See, all of nature is connected with God. They didn't disconnect. So I grow this lettuce, which is really nice, and lettuce seeds are small, so they come up too thick. So I'm thinning this lettuce they sell in the store for like $3-4 a pound, that really nice, tender stuff. Mm-hmm. And I go to my kale plants, and I'm pulling off this kale, these really thick, old, ugly, heavy leaves, and I throw my wheelbarrow. I dump to my chickens, and I watch my chickens kick away that tender $3 a pound stuff and start eating the kale. So I have to stand and say, okay, God, I gotta watch this. And when they finish the kale, they eat the lettuce. And God says, they know what is the most nutritious. They get it. You know, I'm just telling you, and my dog, you saw them eating apples out there. Yeah. If I go to Costco and buy an apple, my dog will not eat it. Mm-hmm. Because she knows they're poisonous. The organic, you want to hear something scary? And here's the word that says in the end days, which we are in now, that they'll say what's wrong is right, mm-hmm. and what's right is wrong.
Right.
My wife went to the store one day and bought these organic carrots, those real small ones. Mm-hmm. And I gave one to my dog, and she wouldn't eat it. So I go to the owner and says, you know, my dog goes in my garden, she pulls carrots out all day long and eats them. And she won't eat your organic carrots. What's up with this? And he got this sad look and he says, Paul, they raise them organically, but the producer sprays them for shelf life and you can feel the slime on them.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Your dog's picking up on that spray.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
They're labeled organic. People are buying them with a clear conscience thinking they're buying organic food and it's got this spray on them that my dog knows is toxic. Won't eat it. So we're living in a time, this is why it says in the scripture, do all things by prayer. When you go to the store, you pray about what you buy.
Right.
I'm serious.
Yeah.
God, is this safe to buy? Is this safe to eat? Mm-hmm. And how you'll know you get led by peace. The word says, let the peace of God rule in your heart. And the word rule in the Greek is be the umpire. You have a peace, you go there. You have a check, I don't know about this, don't do it. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, we're living in a time where we've got to start paying attention.
Right.
We have got to pay attention because things are not as they're said.
Yeah.
Things are not as it was. Yes. And we've got to come back to our Father mm-hmm. and say, God, give us wisdom. Mm-hmm. Is this safe? Is this okay? And in all of your ways, what does the word say? In all of your ways, acknowledge mm-hmm. Him, ask mm-hmm. Him. We're there.
Right.
We better wake up.
Yeah.
Because we're not going to survive if we're not, listening. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So you were talking about the produce at the store and, you know, not being what it is. And when we buy organic, here pretty soon we're going to go check out a local farm, Terra Organics, to try to support a local farmer. What things can we look for when we go there to take a tour, to go buy our produce and our vegetables? What can we look for to make sure it's official and it is, you know, what it is or
pray.
Signs? Just pray.
In all your ways acknowledge Him. You know, this is what's so mind-blowing. It's so simple. And we have a Father who loves us, who really wants to guide us. Mm-hmm. And he'll show you. He'll tell you as you're there. I had the most interesting, last Sunday, a young couple was here, a woman was still breastfeeding the baby, and this guy, he works for Herman Brothers, and he says, I can get this hog fuel. Would that work? And I says, well, hog fuel is just basically, bark and wood. It's not doesn't have any of the branches because you want the needles and leaves with the branches. So they have some branches. And so I says, well, just ask God. He pauses for a moment and he says this. Oh, but they also chip in plywood and chipboard.
Oh, yikes.
And I said to him, and what's in that? Glues and stuff. You want that in your garden? And I says, well, isn't God cool? And his wife said with her mouth, I never knew God answered. I never knew God answered. All I said was, ask God. And then God brought the spontaneous thought. He never thought about the plywood and the chipboard, but God just says, this is what's in it. He's so there for us. He's so, he said, where it says he's an ever-present help in every time of need. Yeah. We don't get it. And we've got it in all of our ways. When you go to that farm, God, give us wisdom. Show us. Lead us. Show us what's good. You see, even organic farmers are not putting minerals back in the soil. Minerals are the foundation to all of life. Do you understand that? Mm-hmm. Do you ever notice the creation story? When God created this most magnanimous, incredible universe, he had the idea in his mind and he spoke it into existence. Let it be. And it's awesome. This planet is gorgeous. And everything on it, the whole thing, he spoke in existence. When it came to the creation of the human race, the whole scene changed. God came down to the planet physically and got in conference with himself and said, let us make man in our own image after us. And he physically took up dust and formed man. Dust are minerals. Minerals is the foundation to all of life, and he breathed into man the breath of life. You know the next thing he did? It just shows you the heart of the Father. The next thing God did, he planted a garden for his kids. I love him. He's so awesome. This is my kids, and I want to take care of them. I'm going to plant this garden for them. He's an awesome God, and we've got to get it. And he really cares for us. He really cares for us. And there's nothing he doesn't want to help us with. And you see, and the word says, in whom Satan has blinded our eyes so we don't see the light. He's told us, God's busy, go to the books. He's totally blinded us not to go to God when he's so there for us.
Right.
He's just saying, yeah, I want to help you. You know, you have kids. When your child comes and asks a question, you stop whatever you're doing and you pour into them because you're so glad they ask. Mm-hmm. And you want to impart, you want to give.
Yeah.
God's a dad. He's a father.
Yes,
he loves his kids. He wants to give to us. He wants to instruct us and enlighten us. And we don't ask. Mm-hmm. It's just, and I love that scripture. You see three times in the scripture. Today, if you'll hear his voice. Mm-hmm. Three times. He goes, we don't listen. We don't ask. So in all of your ways, I'm just telling you, it's just getting so cool. I literally have thrown all the books out of my house. I read no books anymore. Because that's finite man who doesn't see it all. God knows it all. And he's just, and everything I'm getting from the books is not what he's saying. And he's the truth.
Yes.
Yeah, he's the truth. You know, so I'm just thinking like, this is nuts. And what's so cool about it? You're so free. You don't have to get your book. You don't have to call anybody. Just say, hey, God. What's the answer? I loved it. Watching those young people. He was right there for him. Here's the answer, you know? It's
cool.
He's just so there. And so I hope you'll get it. You're not here coincidentally today.
Right.
You guys understand you are not here coincidentally?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really. Mm-hmm. And here's the word. Everybody knows the scriptures. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man or woman be in Christ, they are a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. You know what the next verse says? Does anybody know what the next verse says? Anybody? I have been totally blown away. I do this every... What's that?
We don't look at each other in the same...
The next verse says, and no pastor, no one has ever been here that can answer me. The next verse says, and now, all things are of God. And now, present tense, because you've been changed, everything that comes into your life is of God. And now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and given to us the ministry of reconciliation. And no one knows that.
Mm-hmm.
And we go through life thinking things are coincidental.
Mm-hmm.
Things are accidental. No way.
Yeah.
To the believer, everything that you experience comes from God for a good purpose.
Mm-hmm.
The enemy does stuff to you, but he's going to turn it around for good. And see,
Amen.
That's why he says, in everything give thanks, because all things are of God. And if you give thanks, you get on the positive end of it. Okay, God, that's good. Well, if you're in a negative place and, well, this happened and that happened, and you get down and under it, you miss it all.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you, the word is, we have an owner's manual. We've got to start paying attention. We need to start going by what it says. And to the believer, all things are of God. So when you go to that farm, it says, God, you sent me here. And I'm looking for answers. I need answers, so I'm waiting on you. And as you walk through there, he's going to show you this. You just hear his voices. Look at that. And when you taste things, you're an intelligent being, and God gave you taste buds that will really speak to you. And when you eat stuff that's not good, you know it. There's no nutrition in it. You see, it's minerals that give flavor and vitality to food. When things don't taste good, they're not good. Excuse me? They're not good. I get kids coming here. It's so hilarious. I give them these kids kale. And their parents said, oh, they won't eat that. Watch this. And the kids are down picking more. And their parents said, they won't eat it. It's just, there's nothing wrong with your kids. It's something wrong with you. Right. If you gave them good food, they'd eat it. Right. The food you give is no good. They know what's real.
Our kids like won't eat dog. School lunch. They asked the lunch lady, why do you serve such terrible food
here? Yeah, because they know that. Yeah.
No, they did. My little one, my little boy.
I'm hearing you. Jesus
they
says.
They have no fear, right?
And again, they operate in faith. Jesus says, instead of you come like a little child. Children operate in faith. They believe.
Yeah.
They're not hung up. They didn't go to school yet. Once they go to school, they get wiped out.
Yeah, they don't have no clutter.
They're clear. They're clear. Yeah, and that's why we've got to become like them. Get clear with God. Yeah. Get it, you know? Kind of thing. And it's just so awesome to watch them come here because they just are so, they're on the ground, they're pulling weeds, they're having fun, they're parents. We can't get them to pull weeds at home. Well, it's pleasure here. It's enjoyable. They're eating this stuff. It's like, watch the little kids packing, you know, stuff in their pockets. They can't stuff the carrots in their pockets. Yeah. It's just like awesome because they get it.
Yeah.
And here, we who went to school don't, you know, and this is why we got to come back to God.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Hey,
awesome.
Can I ask you about your pastor, Matt? What do you do for that, if anything?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked. Thank you, God. You know, I missed this, but this is so huge. If you look at my pasture, this, I want you guys to get the power of the covering. You see, I'm on a slight slope here. It's a slight slope.
Mm-hmm.
A pasture of this size, which is an acre and a quarter, will support 5 sheep. 5 sheep. Last July, we're talking July, approaching summer, with no irrigation, a farmer brought 53 adult sheep to my pasture. Because he had them on 25 acres that he'd been using fertilizers, chemical fertilizers, and watering. And the grass was down to the ground, and he was trying to get his pasture back. He says, I'll probably be here for a month. I'll have your grass on a month, but at least it'll give me time to get my pasture back. He didn't take those sheep out until October. They were here for the entire summer with no irrigation, and they never got my pasture down. 53 on an acre and a quarter that's supposed to support 5. These 28 sheep have been here since April. And if you notice, my grass is not down. On an acre and a quarter, it's supposed to be. And here's why. This, I'm so glad, this is so powerful. In that covering out there, in the places my orchard, I haven't put anything for 12 years, puts enough life into the soil to support all those trees, all that produce, and has enough excess to feed this entire pasture, because my ground underneath at 6 to 8 inches is blue clay. And when that composting hits it, it can't penetrate, so it seeps into my pasture. This is all the overflow. This is the extra. This is like, we have so much, we just gotta get rid of it.
Okay.
And I haven't put anything back for 12 years. These are the things that just be out. My mind just goes, wow. I'm looking at farmers today who are going bankrupt, paying for fertilizer and producing less and less every year. Or I'm doing nothing, I get all of that, and then it does this. Extra? Excess? Like, and next year does it better and I don't do anything? It's like, wow.
Aren't you glad you have that clay to keep all that?
And the slope is such an advantage. The slope is just, and so if you have land, the slope you think is bad, plant your good stuff up front, cover it, and all the stuff down below gets free. Free coverage. I'm thinking of farmers who fertilize who have nothing like this, and don't do anything. This is the excess. This is the overflow. And are you so getting the character of God, who mm-hmm. He is? This is His nature.
Yes.
I'm just all about abundance and overflow. And just like, you can't contain it all.
Give you life and give you
life. Yeah. And see, all of nature, this is why it's Romans 1, the invisible attributes are clearly seen by the things He's made.
Mm-hmm.
So that
right.
No one has any excuse not to. It's all there.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why the enemy has done his best to keep us inside of buildings, in cars,
right. mm-hmm.
in offices so we don't see this. Because if you show up in nature, you're going to meet God. You can't miss him. You cannot miss him. It's all there. And this is why he does his best to keep us off on concrete. You could just see this whole thing of cities and all this stuff is diabolic. Mm-hmm. It's not God's design. Mm-hmm. And it's intentional to keep us away from
to
him.
Separate us from
God. Because when you're out here and you're watching this man, you're just blowing away. You're like, wow, God, you're awesome. Yeah. You're just like, ah. It is so cool. Thank you, sir, for asking. Because it's just such a powerful, you know, revelation.
Seems like time is kind of... I mean, I have no actual concept of how long we've been here. I mean, it's just been... Do you understand what I'm saying?
And I want you all to notice...
There
it is. Yeah. As soon as you drove on this place and got out, you sensed a peace.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's the presence of God.
Yeah.
He's here.
Absolutely.
He is here. Mm-hmm. This is why I never want to leave my place. I hang out in the garden all day long because he shows up. All this stuff, all these revelations I get, I never get in church.
Right.
I get him here.
That's right.
Because God doesn't go to church.
Right.
You know that? God does not go to church.
Yeah.
You know what's so crazy about the church? They interpreted Revelation 3:20 as a verse for the unbeliever. I stand at the door and knock. That's for evangelism. Mm-hmm. Jesus is writing to the church in Revelation 3.
Right. That's right.
Jesus is saying, this is my church and I'm on the outside and I'd like to come in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm standing at the door. It's my church. I'm outside. You have an agenda, you have a program, and I'm not invited. It's so pathetic. It's so, like, out of whack. We don't get it. This is what I love about he's always here. He just hangs out here because this is where he made it, you know?
He's on Beach Drive, too, down
the corner. He's everywhere. He's everywhere. Yeah, he's there, you know? And I guess so blessed these unbelievers come here, these New Agers, you know, and one group was here, it was like, oh, you know, I'm talking about God, you can see their body language. But you know, I'm at the place now, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, and they asked to come. I didn't invite them. I'm not charging anything. So you know, you're hearing your own, and I'm going to tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you tell the truth, you always end up with God. Jesus, mm-hmm. I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you tell the truth, you always end up with him. And so as I'm watching their, as they're eating this stuff, I'm watching their body language just shrink away. They're not reacting at God. They were here for like 4 hours. Mm-hmm. This woman's walking off my path out across the garden. She just stops dead in her tracks. She says this, I can't explain this, but as soon as I showed up here today, I was overwhelmed by this sense of peace, and I've never experienced this in my life. I said, I'll tell you who he is. His name is Prince of Peace. That's God. Mm-hmm. I invited him to come. He's been here.
Amen.
And that's who he experienced. And you know, God's going to use that to draw. She won't forget that.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
She Absolutely. Will not forget that. You know, she encountered his presence. Mm-hmm. It's just so awesome.
Yay.
There was this one couple came. It was so cool. They're farmers in Port Townsend, organic farmers. And everybody knows my wife because she's a midwife. She's been doing it for 35 years. So his wife calls on the phone and says, we all know Carol Gauss. We all know he has a garden and an orchard. We never thought we'd come there. We saw your film. We want to come look at your garden. These are organic farmers. He says, we're in farmers markets every day of the week. The only day we have off is Monday. Can we come? So they come. And these guys, the husband and his brother were on the ground picking this stuff up. And they were blown away. Because these are gardeners. These are farmers, organic. And they were realizing what they were seeing. His wife had to go to the bathroom for about 4 hours. As he's in the house, he's in the bathroom, he says this to me. He says, you know, I have traveled the world spending a fortune studying permaculture. And I do not have a garden in my own home because everything I've been taught I know is not right. This is an organic farmer who spent a fortune traveling the world studying permaculture. And he's realizing everything he's been taught is not real. So when I was here today, it brought a memory back to when I was a child in England. My parents on weekends would take us to the coast in our car and we'd go into the woods and we'd pick up compost, wood chips off the ground and bring home, and that was the best food I ever grew. And I saw it today and he said this, I'm going to go home and plant a garden because I found what I'm looking for. As he walked off my driveway, the Holy Spirit says, today he found who he is looking for. He just doesn't know it yet. I started to cry. I broke. I'm realizing, like, this is what I'm here for.
Absolutely.
This is what I'm here for. Mm-hmm. People are wanting to know God.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
They want him so bad and they just don't know it.
Right.
And when he saw this, he realized, this is what I've been looking for my whole life. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yay.
Yay. Yay, God. You know?
Yeah, so I'm just telling you. Preaching the gospel,
what?
Brother.
But, you know, everything about God is good news. Everything.
Yes.
This is all good news.
Absolutely.
There's nothing here today that's not good. because that's his character. That's who he is. So you don't have to try to figure out something. Just start talking about, you know, his goodness, and it's all him, you know. I think. So I just feel so blessed, and thank you for coming, because I just, you know, this is what
thank
I'm here
you.
For.
Thank you for having
that's
us.
Awesome.
You know, yeah. And you know, I love that word in 1 John. John writes in 1 John, he says, "As Jesus is, so are we to be in this world." Mm-hmm. But what did Jesus do? He says, "I don't do anything I didn't see or hear my Father do or say." Mm-hmm. And I just get the privilege of just channeling God to mm-hmm. all of you.
Amen.
Just giving away, because he's good. You know, so thank you. You know.
Yeah. thank you. Awesome. Yeah.
God bless you.
You talk about the enemy, like in Matthew, the evil one.
Yeah.
But there are other enemies. Monsanto, Cargill.
Oh, yeah. Well, they're all under the influence of the enemy.
But they would like this not to happen. Do you feel protected by the Holy Spirit?
God, I'm going to tell you something.
So,
this film came out. I'll tell you, when this film was happening, and there was times in the film, there was one place where I actually had to, was the Holy Spirit just shut my mouth. Because he told me up front, don't you dare say one word about Monsanto. Don't you mention their name. And I'll just tell you that they are a powerful entity. There was a professor who was about ready to retire. All he said in the speech was, "I will not eat genetically modified food," and the guy lost his job.
Mm-hmm.
Totally was lost Absolutely. His job as a professor like that.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And the Holy Spirit said to me, "Don't you dare mention him." Can I tell you something powerful about this simple film? No big deal film. In the first year, it was seen by over 20 million people in 200 countries.
The Back to Eden film.
Mm-hmm. With no advertising.
Yeah.
And what it's about is, it has God's anointing
mm-hmm.
and his favor.
Right.
And I get calls from all over the world. I've gotten calls from FDA people who work for the FDA, who is a human being who says, "I was blown away by this. This would be the answer to the, you know,
mm-hmm.
growing." I mean, he works for the FDA, but he's a human being,
right.
And he saw it. I'm getting calls from people from when I first came out from Florida. Says, "I saw your film on a government environmental site." You know, it's just dramatic what God's done. And you know what I'm getting? Psalm 91, and all of you need to get this. If you don't know it, memorize it. Because we're living in a time when everything that can be shaken will be shaken.
That's right.
God says, I love God. He's so upfront. He tells you everything's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But our reality needs to be Psalm 91. We are under the shadow of the Almighty. Can I tell you something powerful about the wood chips I didn't share? This is, you guys have a minute?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
The wood chips not only are an insulator to the ground and protected from the cold, it also acts as a filter. This was so huge. When the film came out, some agency called the girls who did it and said, "This, what you said in the film is a total erroneous statement. You need to correct it. To say that produce grown in wood chips would have the same nutritional value as those grown with fertilizer is erroneous. Fertilizer definitely improves the value of food products." The girl says, "We don't know that. Do the test and we'll publish it." So they went out and they maxed out the fertilizer on the soil. And then right next to it, they covered wood chips and planted stuff. When they examined the plants, they were shocked to find that the stuff in the wood chips had more nutritional value than the stuff in the chemical fertilizers. So they did this. This is how brain dead they were. They put chemical fertilizers on the wood chips to think that they could upgrade those plants. So they dump all these chemical fertilizers and then water it again, like, oh, see how this changes it. You know what was so cool after they tested it? There was absolutely no change. And the Holy Spirit just says, "I want you to remember that. That's significant." And then, see, when God speaks to me, he always does this thing, and the word says, "In the mouth of two or three witnesses, truth is always validated." So I get a call from a woman in the Gulf Coast there, in Louisiana. Says, "I'm an avid gardener. I've been growing food for my whole life. And with these two storms we've had, has totally wiped out all my fruit trees and all my garden, because salt water has totally covered my whole yard, and all my trees died, all my garden's dead, and I don't know if I have the courage to do it again." And the Holy Spirit immediately prompted me to ask her, "Do you have any wooded areas where you live?" This is yes. "How are they doing?" "Oh, they're fine." "Well, get it." That covering acted as a filter, and that salt never got to the roots. So these chemtrails and all this trash Satan is doing right now to take us out is never affecting my plants. I am under the shadow of the Almighty. And I don't care what they do, all that evil that's happening out there is not going to affect me.
Right.
Now, I want to give you a powerful definition of courage. Courage is knowing that nothing can take you out until your appointed time.
Amen.
Nothing. There is appointed unto man and woman once to die, after this is judgment. Until your point in time, you're safe. There's nothing to fear, and we're good. And in the meantime, I'm looking forward to all the systems failing. And I'll tell you what I'm hearing in the spirit. God's a jealous God, and he has a right to be because he has no equals. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
He has no equals.
Right.
And he's had it with all the lies. Mm-hmm. He's going to take out all the false gods, and he's doing it. Mm-hmm. If you go to the hospital today, that's a false god because he's a healer. If you go to the hospital today, you're going to come out with staff and mercy. You'll never get well. Mm-hmm. Antibiotics no longer work. All the banks all over the world are failing. That's a false god. He's our provider. He's taking out all these false gods so that those that know him will connect, have his spirit on him, have his power, and the world will come running to us. Who's Amen. Your God? Who is your God? And we're going to be witnesses when we can be. I'm looking forward to it. Let it all come down. Take it all out, God. Because you know what I have happening here? I have everything I need from Father God. He provides my seed, a sun grows, and I need nothing from anybody. And all Monsanto's garbage will die with them because I don't need it. See, you know, it says in Revelation about all the stuff that comes on the earth, the famines, the pestilence. That's not God being mad, the earthquakes. You know what earthquakes are happening more today than ever? Mm-hmm. You men understand the shock absorber in your car, what's in it? It's oil. Mm-hmm. And when you hit a bump, instead of that spring giving you a bounce, that shock absorber absorbs the shock and you go through smoothly. God put in the earth huge pockets of oil to absorb the shock as the earth moves on its plates on a continuous basis. Mm-hmm. Excuse me? As we have taken the oil out of the earth and nothing goes back to fill those spaces, when the earth shifts now on its place, it's huge, dramatic, and a lot more often.
Wouldn't that be because of the fracking or whatever? I forget what it is.
Well, we're taking out what God has in the earth, thinking that we can use it and burn it, and no consequences. Be not deceived. God will not be mocked. Whatever you sow, you reap. Because we're pulling this out, we're having earthquakes. Mm-hmm. We're having famines because Monsanto is controlling the seed, and they will make the famines happen. We're having pestilence because the ground's weak and the plants are weak and not getting food. All these things are the results of man's rejection of God, his greed, and the tribulation is evidence of be not deceived, God's not mocked, you'll reap what you sow. He's not angry, he's not upset. This is just choices we made that are having consequences of. He's a good God. Mm-hmm. You know, and so we've got to wake up to reality and so start connecting with him. But I'm just looking forward to all the stuff collapsing all around me because this is not going to happen here. Mm-hmm. And when my time comes, I'm only a pilgrim stranger. This is not my home anyway. I'm glad to get out of here.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to a much better place. You know, I'm thinking, I have a hard time walking, You know how I'm going to get around for eternity? I'm going to be able to travel at the speed of thought. Mm-hmm. Travel at the speed of thought. Because Jesus did. After the resurrection, he didn't come through that door, through that wall. He was just there.
That's right.
I love it. Philip, just there.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, my future is awesome. Yeah. I have an incredible future. Yeah. I'm not hung up in this silly planet, man.
Right.
I'm glad to get out of here. So when my time comes, I'm out of here.
As I've heard you often say, that's bigger than me.
Yeah, it is. And I love it. God is good, and we have an incredible future, and we got to start waking up and keeping our focus on him and on his word. What I love about the word, he tells us everything that's going to happen. He's so up in the light. He's so up front. There's no reason to be in fear. Right. All this stuff that's going around us, wars and rumors, we're there. Everything you read, it's serial. Yeah. I mean, we're just there. He says it's going to happen. Don't be alarmed.